Recently, things are getting a little hot when it comes to the Ampere launch. Even a Bangsawan like me is getting, what's the word? Fire boil. Foguan. Benda ni memang buat saya panas, ya. Now mind. Today, I chill. Because today we're gonna be reviewing the INNO3D iChill RTX 3080. Chill lah! So kanchong for what? Now I'm sure that it's no longer a secret that the recent Ampere or RTX 3000 series launch has its share of problems. Some reviewers as well as early adopters have been reporting major issues when it comes to their RTX 3080s, but with sources such as Igor's Lab and the famous YouTuber Jay's Two Cents speculating that they know what the cause to these problems are, and they think it has to do with the use of what they claim are inferior components in some of the PCB designs from the ARB partners compared to the FE edition. Because most of these issues occur when the GPUs are getting pushed close to or exceeding 2 GHz with games crashing and all these other nasty issues. Now, I'm not an engineer with enough credibility to comment on these claims, but after many hours of reading into the topic, I think that things could either be as they claim or a lot more complicated than what we can understand. Now, our iChill X4 card from INNO3D has a design of 5 Poscaps with 10 MLCCs in one array, as opposed to the 4 Poscaps and 20 MLCCs in 2 arrays from the Founders Editions. And I can say that we haven't encountered any major issues in the past 2 weeks of testing this card. So read into that whatever you may. While I do sympathize with you early adopters who went out there and spent your hard-earned cash to buy an RTX 3080 and it came with problems, I do urge that you keep a cool head and wait for an official word from either Nvidia or the AIB partners, because I'm really sure that they don't want to be screwing with us customers, because the customer is always right. Unless you are left-handed, then I guess you are left, lor. Just an update, Nvidia has released a driver update version 456.55 on September 29th that according to some AIB partners seem to have fixed the issue for them. But still, in a response provided to PC World, Nvidia stated that the appropriate number of Poscap versus MLCC groupings can vary depending on the design and is not necessarily indicative of quality. Gamer Nexus and other sources have made an update post about this issue, and it seems that not every card which opted for all Poscaps were crashing, although most reports from early adopters seem to be correlating with those designs. Also, not all those black chunkier capacitors are Poscaps. Some of them are actually SP caps, however both are polymer capacitors which kind of look the same to the untrained eye. Now, Steve from GN stated that the cause of the problem could indeed be a driver issue or a problem with the PCB design separately, or in some cases both, but he cited that the lack of testing with real use case scenarios was the main culprit, as partners have only gotten proper drivers that worked with games mere days before the launch, no doubt to prevent leaks and such. So the Mobhouse team have tried our best to recreate the conditions that have been reported to cause crashes online, but alas, we couldn't get our iChill X4 RTX 3080 to crash no matter if we gamed on it for hours in various titles or even used it for GPU intensive productivity tasks. Nothing. And I don't know if this is relevant or not, but here is the official word from INNO3D themselves. Okay, I digress. Today we're gonna check out the INNO3D iChill X4 RTX 3080. Why is it X4 and not X3, you may ask? Good question! Because here we have 4 fans. 1, 2, 3, and one on top, guai guai shi shi. Number 4. Don't know how to count, is it? Go back to school ah. Oh, no stock cannot count, is it? What you tell me? Go and complain to Nvidia lah. I'm just a Bangsawan. With an RTX 3080 that you got money also cannot buy. Wow, who write one this script? Like, not enough enemies outside, is it? Oh, nanti kena belasah baru tau. Eh, nevermind oh, I got guardhouse mah. Okay, jokes aside. Now, we all know that this card is meant for people who already own the RTX 2080, 2080 Super, or 2080 Ti, because we want to see if it's worth the upgrade. So here are the specs of the RTX 3080 as compared to those cards that I just mentioned. First and foremost, the RTX 3080 has 28 billion transistors and a slightly larger die size compared to the RTX 2080 and a smaller one compared to the RTX 2080 Ti. In terms of CUDA cores, we have almost double the amount of the RTX 2080 Ti and almost 3 times the amount of the RTX 2080. And also more RT cores, and these are also second gen cores as compared to the first gen cores from the 2080 and 2080 Ti. Other improvements include more TFLOPs and more ROPs. The memory has been upgraded from GDDR6 to GDDR6X. Now we have 10GB of it as compared to 8GB on the RTX 2080 and 11GB on the 2080 Ti. There's been an improvement in memory speed and also the bus type and bandwidth. Finally, we have TDP, which is 320 watts that is higher than both the 2080 Ti and 2080. What is truly noteworthy about the RTX 3080 is that it's launching at the same price of the RTX 2080, but it outperforms in theory the RTX 2080 Ti, which launched at $1,200 US, or in Malaysia, that's more like 6,000 plus to 7,000 plus. So those are the specs. Now let's just take a closer look at this INNO3D iChill X4. Firstly, when it comes to the aesthetics, this is a pretty sleek card compared to the previous iChill iterations. It is a 3 expansion slot card that is mostly black with gunmetal and silver accents on the logo, as well as some markings on the back plate. When it comes to ARGBs, it is a lot more mature and sophisticated, which is just what I like. You might like the whole abing, feng tao, douche douche ARGBs, in which case, your problem ah. Something else that I like with this card is that cutout behind on the backplate, where you can see the post caps as well as the MLCC array. It looks kinda tacky and geeky and sexy. Another thing that's pretty cool about this iChill card is actually the thermal design. Here we have a massive heat sink with 8 heat pipes and a copper base plate that also covers the MOSFET to give us effective cooling for the components. Apparently the 9cm fan on top is to provide more cooling to the MOSFET. And we also have the Tune-It software to help with controlling OC as well as RGB. So kudos. Here are the specs of our test bench. For the CPU, we have the AMD Ryzen 7 3800XT. For CPU cooler, we have the Thermaltake Water 3.0 360 ARGB Sync AIO. And for the motherboard, we have the ASRock X570 Taichi. RAM, we have 32GB of GEIL Super Luce AMD Edition DDR4, rated at 3200 MHz. SSD, we have 2TB of Gigabyte Aorus M.2 PCIe Gen 4 SSD. And finally, for the power supply, we have the Corsair RM850 watts 80 plus gold PSU. Firstly, we have synthetic benchmarks, and to kick things off, we have 3D Mark x Spy Extreme. The RTX 3080 scored 7877 compared to 6138 from the 2080 Ti. That's around a 28% improvement. Not too bad, considering that it is launched at almost half the price. As compared to the 2080, the 3080 performed around 58% better. That's quite impressive, but still not really the 2x performance claimed by Nvidia. Next, we also tested Unigine superposition. Once again, the 3080 scored 28% better than the 2080 Ti and 62% better than the 2080. Seems like these are the raw performance improvements that we can expect from the 3080. However, for gaming, we'll need to see how developers utilize ray tracing and DLSS. Next, for gaming, wanted to test out Minecraft RTX, which is supposedly where Nvidia got their 2x 2080 performance, but we were unable to get it to install. So, moving on! So here we have Shadow of the Tomb Raider, which supports both ray tracing and DLSS. We'll be running the game with both features on and off to see, firstly, how much raw performance we are gaining in this generation, as well as if there are improvements in ray tracing and DLSS from this 3080 versus previous generations. At 1440p, there were no significant improvements. It could be a scaling issue, but we are not sure. Things get really impressive when we move to 4K, and this is where the 3080 shines. With only DLSS on, we gained about 14 FPS compared to the 2080 Ti, which equates to a 16% improvement. It also did 50% better than the 2080. That's around 100 FPS in 4K and is really impressive. Once we turned on ray tracing, we saw an 11% improvement compared to the 2080 to a respectable 75 frames per second, which is very playable in a game like this. With both DLSS and ray tracing off, we gained about 28% in FPS compared to the 2080 Ti, hitting a very, very respectable 77 frames per second. That's quite a bit more raw performance. This means that the 28% improvement over the 2080 Ti scaled properly here in pure rasterization performance. It was also 185% better than the 2080, with our 2080 only getting 27 frames per second in testing. We also tested Death Stranding, and this game only supports DLSS with no ray tracing, so let's see how much the 3080 has improved. At 1440p, once again, there is not much difference. In 4K with DLSS on though, we are getting a 7% and 15% boost respectively compared to the 2080 Ti and 2080. The performance improvements is actually bigger with DLSS off because the 3080 hit similar numbers as when DLSS was on, and that would indicate that DLSS is still in the works for this card for this game. But evidently, DLSS benefit the previous gen cards because the performance gap is larger here, with the 3080 having a 28% lead over the 2080 Ti and a 58% improvement over the 2080. Next, we tested Battlefield 5, and this game was used to showcase RTX features when the first gen RTX cards were launched. So what changed? In 4K with ray tracing and DLSS on, we're getting around 18% more FPS compared to the 2080 Ti and around 50% in terms of improvement compared to the 2080. Not too shabby. Looking at raw performance, with DLSS and ray tracing off, the 3080 got 29% more FPS compared to the 2080 Ti and 63% more FPS compared to the regular 2080. Finally, to put Nvidia's CUDA cores to the test for our everyday use, we rendered a 3.5-minute 4K video in Premiere Pro with our usual output settings, and here are the results. We're only getting about 6% better times compared to the 2080 Ti and 9% better times compared to the 2080, but the rendering times in Premiere Pro is still very dependent on the CPU, and the GPU is just accelerating it, so your mileage may vary depending on how many GPU accelerated effects you are using. And if you are doing 3D work and stuff like that, you'll probably see more improvement in this department. So what's the verdict? Kesimpulan ya, the RTX 3080 when it comes to pure rasterization performance perform 30% faster than the RTX 2080 Ti and 60% faster than the RTX 2080. When it comes to ray tracing and DLSS performance, it varies from game to game. Now, Nvidia reported that this card performs up to 2 times faster than the RTX 2080 in Minecraft ray tracing. But according to our own test, that's not the case with other games. Keeping that in mind, we do hope that all this information that we share with you today can help you make a more informed decision to buy or not to buy this RTX 3080. Now, I know that there's a lot of scandalous news going around regarding this launch, but I personally still think that the RTX 3080 is the right step towards a good direction for Nvidia to provide us with good price to performance ratio in a graphics card like this, no matter if you're a gamer, creative professional, or Bangsawan consumer that's just gonna buy this to play Minesweeper. So that's all, folks. If you thought this video is awesome, don't forget to give us a like and share. Leave a comment down below to let us know what you think about this whole Nvidia fiasco, as well as if you have bought the RTX 3080 yourself. Are you having problems or no problems? Let me know, okay? I'll see you in the next one. Black lay my hand.